Exodus chapter number 25. I will give you our theme verse for the first quarter of the year. And this message and this theme has been working on me for about 6 weeks. And I'll tell you, this is what I want in my life. I want to get where God is. Exodus 25, verse 8 is our theme verse. And I'll read verse number 9. I'll be introducing you to the tabernacle this morning. And I may preach some sermons on the tabernacle. But I want you to look at Exodus 25 and verse number 8. Whew, boy, I'm overwhelmed this morning. And let them make me a sanctuary. Here's the theme. That I may dwell among them. That I may dwell among them. If there's anything this old preacher wants for this year is that God dwells among us. See, here's the problem is not that we don't have a distant God. If anything, we got an ever-present God. We got a God that comes through. How many of you last year he come through for you? Come on now, raise your hand. You had a crisis, he come through. I see one of our sisters, she came back from surgery. Sister Robin, good to see you today. And I'm glad you're back and doing better. And we missed you, but I'm glad that God came through for you. And there's others of you. I ought to just get up and want to shout this morning that God came through for you. He said he'd never leave us nor forsake us. He said he'd go all the way with us. I still believe that. Say amen right there. And then look at verse number 9. According to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall you make it. So hear what God's saying. He's saying, you're going to build me a house to dwell in. And by the way, I'll be showing you later on in the messages, everything about the tabernacle pointed to Jesus. Boy, our brother preached in Sunday school this morning, being at the feet of Jesus. Him and I kind of getting together. Our message, I didn't know what he's preaching. He didn't know what I was preaching. But we kind of together today because we need to get where God is. And if you get where God is, you're going to get where Jesus is because Jesus is the God-man. Jesus is the personification of God. He was God in the flesh. Well, praise God. I will show you, there's three compartments I'll show you. First of all, I want to talk about the person of God. By the way, I'm talking about a holy God. Amen. How many believe he's a holy God? A thrice holy God. And I'm talking about a God. Let me say this, church. Here's our problem. It's not that God, we don't have God. How many of you saved know you're saved? Raise your hand if you're saved and you know you're saved. By the way, you got all the Holy Ghost you ever get. You don't have to get no more. There's crowds out there today trying to conjure up God and get God. You know, they go through phases to get the Holy Ghost in them. I want you to know something. I got a one short fuse phase. January 31st. 1973, I got saved by the grace of God, and the Holy Ghost of God came in and dwelled in me. He's Christ in you, the hope of glory. I'm sealed unto the day of redemption. I can't be lost. I'm on my way to heaven. I got God in me. Amen. Woo! See, the problem is not that we don't have God. That's not our problem. Problem is, God don't have us. Here's what I want. I want all that God has for me this coming year. I don't want second best. As too many of us are settling for second best. I personally believe this is a good church, a very good church. And I think we're on the brink of being a great church. But I want to tell you what, if we're going to be the church that God wants us to be, if we're going to be the people God wants us to be, we're going to get where God is. Somebody say amen right there. And in this tabernacle, there was three compartments. I'll be talking about that in a little while. The outer court, the holy place, and then the holies of holies where God was. You know, there's too many of us sitting out there on the outer court. I tell you what the church has done in these days. We have tried to get professional singers and change our music to get to where God is. Can I tell you a little story? I was down in Georgia. Oh, it's been 10 years ago. Preaching with Joe Arthur and a couple of those fellas in a big camp meeting down there. They had, you know, the service going good, and I was sitting on the front, and here come three ladies up on the stage. And if you looked at those ladies, you would have said, man, what are they doing on a stage this big? They was humble, dressed humbly, dressed modest, and all of a sudden, them three girls got singing. How many's ever heard the Hendersons? None of y'all? No wonder you ain't where God is. Hey, man, I'm going to tell you what. They started to sing. Those you ever hear them sing? You know how they are. They got God on them. Listen to me. They ain't professional. Some of them, help me, they don't even dress professional. They don't look professional, but I want you to know they got God on them. Amen. Let me say something for our choir. I want to say something for our program. You know, we can have all the greatest choir in the world, the greatest programs in the world, but what we need is a choir, a church, a program, is that God is on everything we do. Somebody help me right there. Amen. Oh, we also trying to get to... I'm going to tell you what, the churches, there's many of them just going downhill. They get their little contemporary music and let's do away with seats up here and let's get some smog going. Ain't no wonder God isn't there. He couldn't find his way in there. Am I preaching? And then here's what's going on. You know, it's kind of funny to me. Because I got a little bit on me and I preach the word of God, they say, well, he's a preacher and not a teacher. We give more word here in 20 minutes than most churches give in 5 weeks. Amen. Amen. Just because we're a little excited, somebody help me. You ever get where God is, you'll get excited. And I had a church member, he's living in sin, made the excuse that we was kind of shallow, and he said, I ain't going to leave because we were shallow. No, he left because he was a drunk. Okay. Hello. I'm preaching. He couldn't stand hard preaching. So anything hard was muddy. Anything hard wasn't deep. Listen to me, you don't need an orator. Hey, I thank God for an old leather neck preacher, one that just says, I got the goods and the Holy Ghost is on him and he'll preach and with power. We don't need no little sermonettes to Christian acts. We need a powerful message from God. Amen. Well, glory. Man, I'm getting beside myself this morning now. Let me give you three things and I'll try to wind this pony up. I can't even get going today, Brother Jeremy. Whew. Let me talk about three things about this tabernacle. First of all, we got the person. We got the person. That's God. How many believe we need him? Amen. But also we have the pattern. Father, I'm going to get something across to you right now. You are not going to get where God is without a pattern. You're not going to flim-flam your way to God. God's not like that. And there's a pattern in this tabernacle. They were told to build it this way. And I'm going to give you some pictures of it in the weeks prior on as we get into this series. They had an outer court. That also was known as the court of the Gentiles. Now, in that outer court was a brazen laver. In that outer court
was also a brazen altar. Let me say it first, a brazen altar and then a brazen laver. I want to say this to you. If you're going to get to where God is, you're going to find that it's a place of suffering. That altar, Brother Jared, I'm convinced that that altar was a picture of the cross of Calvary. I'm convinced. You say, why are you convinced? Well, it was overlaid with brass. Brass speaks of judgment. I also had four horns. I'm glad for the four gospels. And by the way, I'm glad for the power of the gospel. The word horn is the word power. I want to tell you something. You'll never get where God is until you get born again. Somebody help me. You got to, hey, you got to come to that outer court. You got to come to that place of sacrifice, that place of suffering, and you've got to meet Jesus Christ personally. I just tell you what's wrong with most of our churches. They done away with altar calls. Hello. Done away with them. I got invited, a few months ago, maybe even a year ago, I was invited to a church. You ever get invited somewhere and you wonder why they invited you? Come on. I mean, I've been in dead places, okay? But that was the deadest dead that I ever been in. You said, what do you do when you're in a dead place? Preach, man. I preach about Jesus. I'm going to be honest with you. I preach that dead place. I'm telling you, dead. They had one song before I preached. Didn't have no choir. Didn't have no prelude. All they did, the preacher got up and went, good to have you, Dave. I really don't think he meant that. Good to have you, Dave. Hope you come out for the right reason. I thought, what am I doing here? We got an evangelist. I don't know him. But I've heard good things about him. I don't know if he meant that, but... They had some song. Everybody have a preference on music. That wasn't my preference. Okay. I just go stop right there. And they got me up and I said, what do you do at the end? He said, we don't do anything. We just let them go. I said, you don't have no invitation? He said, not normally. I said, well, I'm going to do my thing, okay. So now I got up there with Brother Denny, and I just said, well, I'm going to preach Jesus. I preached about the cross. I'm going to tell you, I preached about the cross. And you know what happened? God got all over that place. They got eight saved on the first night I preached. Out of the eight, six of them were over 65 years old. And those six out of the eight, that over 60 had been a member of that church, charter members, never been born again, never got saved. I tell you why the church is dying tonight. We're letting people in as members that ain't never been saved. They ain't never been under the spout where the glory got out. I want to tell you something. We want something from God. We want to get near God. We need to be born again. You need to come by the way of the cross. You need to come by the brazen altar. Well, hallelujah. It takes suffering. It took sacrifice. It took his best. But I want to tell you something. Remember what I said. We got an outer court, Jerry. And the goal is to get from the outer court to the holy place. And then after we dwell there a little bit, then we want to get in behind the veil. Because that's where God is. See, I want to tell you something. I don't always stay there. But that's where I want to be. I just don't want to be on the outer court. Come on, help me preach a little bit. You say, what's that laver about? By the way, that laver was brass also. And it speaks of judgment. And some of you need to look at yourself. Are you the Christian you were last year? Well, are you a better Christian now as you were last year? You read your Bible more now than you did last year. You passing out tracts more now than you did last year? Are you giving like you did last year? Are you giving, or are you doing, hey, somebody help me? Let me tell you what that, boy, that labor, Brother Jeff, that labor, you know what it had in the, it had water in it. And you know what was on the bottom? Mirrors. Mirrors. Because what happened, that priest got his hands bloody by sacrifice. And he got his feet dirty by walking. By the way, we sometimes get our hands dirty and our feet dirty. And I want you to know something. God ain't going to bless you with a dirty hands and dirty feet. You're not getting in the holy place with dirty hands and dirty feet. If your walk is dirty and your service is dirty, you're not getting where God is. Somebody help me preach right there. And I want you to know that labor, not only as the altar speaks of sacrifice and suffering, but that labor speaks of separation and sanctification. Amen. I'll tell you what's wrong with our church. Let's just tell it like, can I just tell it like it is? Too worldly. Kind of rough way to start 2016. Too worldly. Got some of, hey, some of you watched the game last night and you drank your beer. Shame on you. By the way, you ain't getting in no holy place. Well, it's quiet in here now. Won't some of y'all say amen or ouch or something? I want in the holy place. I want to get where God is. But I'm not going to get where God is if I'm dirty. Got dirty service. By the way, hey, listen to me. If we're going to do anything, it ought to be for the glory of God. Hey, this ain't about John Smith. It ain't about 12 deacons. It ain't about even you. It's about God. It's about lifting him up. It's about a service that is clean and holy and righteous. Somebody help me right there. Yeah, hallelujah. I tell you what. Let me give you, you got your notes? Write this in your notes. In the Bible, if it's water in a basin and not moving, it's the word. If it's a river flowing, it's speaking of water, speaking of the Holy Ghost. Am I right? That labor. By the way, if you ain't reading your Bible every day, you ain't gonna get very clean. You know, you need to make a commitment. What is it, Jen? I had to read 3 chapters a day to read the thing through. Is that right about right? Come on, tell me.
I think it's 3 a day, and then you got to do 6 on Sunday.
That's it. 3 a day and 6 on Sunday. 3 a day and 6 on Sunday. You said, well, I ain't got time for three chapters. That's God speaking to you. You know what we need a revival of? We need a revival of Christians reading the Bible again. We need a revival of Christians. Am I preaching? Because see, down under that water was mirrors. The only way you can see your dirty hands and your dirty feet is to see them in the light of God's word, in the mirror of God's word. And if you're not in God's word, you ain't going to see your dirtiness. And I say the Christian that is in God's word, they're the person that is more sensitive to the word of God, more sensitive to altar calls, more sensitive. Somebody, am I preaching? Amen. You say, I want the holy place. Well, you're not going to get there unless you're born again. And you're not going to get there unless you're clean. Oh, I'm going on. Let me give you a second thing. Whew, this is just an introduction, by the way. Y'all do know that, don't you? Then the holy place. Write this down. It's a type of the local church. 3 things was in there. How many of y'all know what was in the holy place? Well, you're going to learn. It had a table of shewbread. Now, Jared, do you ever study that out? How many loaves of bread was on there? Huh? 12. And do you, I had one preacher say this. He ain't right about it, but I do, you know. He got a little bit away from what it is, a picture of the Word of God. By the way, how many of y'all come to church to get something? Amen. Had a table of shoe bread. Had six pieces of bread, six loaves one way and six loaves another way. I had one preacher preach. He said, that's talking about the King James Bible, 66 books. Now, we believe in the King James Bible, but that ain't what that is, okay? So somebody help me preach right there. The King James Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God, but let's don't stretch something, okay? No, what that's typifying of is feeding from the Word of God. That's what you get in the local church. You know what? I tell you what, some people are going, they kind of go into church to get some professional help and not the right kind. So their business will grow. So they can get some contacts. Oh, you need a contact, and it ain't other people. It's God Almighty. Somebody help me right there. Amen. Yeah. Amen. There's something else in there. Something else in there. There was a lampstand in there. Had seven branches. Speaks of the completeness of the church. In that lampstand, you want run down through that lampstand was oil. You know what that oil was? Picture of the Holy Ghost. And that lampstand lit up. By the way, if you're going, boy, I'm about ready to preach right now. I'm just trying to help you. You said, how many of y'all, look at me, how many of y'all say, well, I don't read the Bible much because I don't understand it? I know why. I know why. Because you're stumbling in darkness. Hey, could you imagine them priests going in that holy place and trying to get them a piece of bread and can't see the bread? The lampstand's a picture of the church, and the oil is a picture of the Holy Ghost. I say this, you can't understand this Bible without the Holy Ghost. Amen. It's spiritually discerned. Carnal man understandeth not the things of God, neither can they know them, for they are spiritually discerned. You want to know this book? You got to get into the light of God. You got to have the power of the Holy Ghost. Somebody help me. We preaching all right. I'm not going to preach an hour and a half, but I could this morning. Don't y'all die on me. There's something else in there. See, I am convinced that this thing is not that hard if you do it right. I'm convinced of that. I'm gonna be a little bit like Lee Robinson right now. You know what Lee Robinson preached on just about most of the time? Read your Bible, surrender the Holy Ghost, and pray. You know what was in that tabernacle or in that holy place? We had the shoe bread, read your Bible. We had the light, the Holy Ghost. And then we had the altar of incense. That's prayer. You want to be a Christian? You want to get where God is? You say, I want where God is. You really want where God is? You're not going to get back in the holy holies unless you come into the church in the holy place and partake of the bread. And some of you said, well, I like your preaching most of the time until you get on some of my problems. Don't bow your head, because if you do, I'm plowing you right now. What you think? We all got problems. Let's just tell the truth. We're all about a half a mess. But the only hope for us is to get in the holy place, feed off the Word of God, dwell in the light of Christ, and pray at the altar of incense. Amen. And I still believe God answers prayer. I still believe God's on the throne. Woo! I'm about to get happy now. We getting anywhere? We're getting somewhere, but we ain't got where we need to be yet. Because see, it's just introduction. Y'all learn anything? We had the outer court. Place of sacrifice, place of sanctification. We got the inner court, place of prayer, place of Bible study, place of the power of the Holy Ghost. But then there was a veil. By the way, they say that you could put two D9 dozers on each side of the veil and you couldn't rent it. And what the priest done is he went in behind the veil to a place called the Holies of Holies, the place where God dwells. See, here's what happened. Somebody help me. Here's what happened. God's light, the Shekinah glory, would come over. There was something else in that thing called the Ark of the Covenant. Am I right? And inside that ark was some items. Did y'all know that? Aaron's rod that budded. How many of y'all like know what that means? I'm going to tell you anyhow. That's resurrected power. You ever get into the holies of holies, you're going to have resurrected power. And boy, now here's where this Bible comes in. You know what else was in there? Manna. Now, they gave him manna all the time. Fresh manna. But this manna's been in there a while. Manna's a picture of the Word of God. I'm going to tell you what, I believe this with all my heart. And these liberal friends of mine that's left fundamentalism and left old-timey religion, they don't believe in the preservation of the Word of God, but you're looking to somebody, that manna was preserved from generation to generation, never got old, never got stale. Can I say something about the Word of God? It never gets old. It never gets stale. It is preserved. Somebody said, well, we just don't have a Bible anymore. We got a bunch of them. The NIV and the SAV and the AVC and the N and the HIV and I'm real sick of this. I'm real sick of something. People today, some of these liberals say, and I'm talking about in Baptist churches, say we just don't have the copy of the Word of God, that it was preserved in the originals. I don't want to shake you up, Anthony, but there ain't no originals. There's ancient manuscripts, and I ain't got time to preach on that, but if you want to come to our school, you will really learn something. But I want to tell you what, if we don't have a preserved word today, then God's a liar, and the Bible's a liar, and we ought to just shut her down. I really believe the Bible said, forever is thy word settled in heaven. If God's word say reserved forever, how many believe forever is right now also? Somebody say amen. God's gave us an English Bible. It's the King James Bible. Hey, listen, there's over 4,700 manuscripts where we got from that our Bible from, and they all are consistent. The NIV, the ASV, and all those Vs, they come from 60 manuscripts. And they don't even agree with one another. I just think I'm going to stay by the old stuff. Preach the old book. If we're going to make it this new year, we're going to do it by the old stuff. We're going to stay by the old stuff. Whew. Oh, I got to go on. There's something else back here. The broken law was back here. Showed us that we was a wicked bunch. And aren't you glad over that broken law was a mercy seat? Amen. And that's where the blood was. I want to tell you, the law is a schoolmaster to bring you to Christ. But I want to tell you, the only way you can be saved is saved by the blood. Amen. Hey, how many of y'all like to, this year, for maybe the first time in your life, get where God is? God's not in the outer court. God's not even in the holy place. God's in the holies of holies. Now you got to come by the outer court, and then you got to get in the holy place in fellowship. But until you get right, you You're not getting back there where he is. You know, this altar ought to be filled full this morning of people who say in 2016, I want to be where God is. Don't you think? Every pastor in this church ought to be on the altar saying, I need to be where God is. Every deacon, every Sunday school teacher, every layman, we ought to need to come to the altar. Bow your head with me.
When he said, whosoever come, the Lord of all creation gave his life for my salvation. So undeserved, it's hard for me to understand God's Son would give this invitation, this wondrous revelation, whosoever.